Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. I'm Mrs. Bads, the Learning Mama. I make videos on how to make researching, parenting, and homemaking a little bit fun and easy. In this video, I'm going to discuss how to introduce a qualitative study. It took me a long time to upload this and to create this video because, as I've mentioned in my previous vlogs, I'm not really into qualitative study. But today, I finally had the confidence to share with you some tips on how to write the backer of the study in terms of qualitative approach. So I'm using the book Inquiry and Research Design, published in 2007 by John Creswell. So that will be my main reference for this video. So let's start. In introducing the study using qualitative approach, we have these three things in mind. First is the problem, the issue, or the need that leads to the creation of your study. Next is the purpose of your study. And last but not the least is the research questions, which we will discuss in another video. So in this video, I will only discuss with you the problem and the purpose, which will be part of the background of the study. How to write the background of the study? First is to mention the problem source. I will discuss this later on. Next is to frame it with literature. I've made a video about this already, how to write the background of the study for quantitative. Basically, that's the content using the inverted pyramid. So this is the video. I'm gonna link it down in the description box so you can watch it later. Last part of the background of the study is the foreshadowing your approach to inquiry in the purpose statement. So this may be the first time that you encounter these words, but don't worry, we'll discuss this in this video as well. So let's start with the source of the problem. When we say sources of the problem, it can be your personal experience. If you are working and you are tasked to do a research work, it can be a job-related problem. It can be, for example, you are in the academic field and you have an advisor who has an agenda for research. They gave you a specific topic, so that can be a source of a problem. And lastly, another source of the problem is the scholarly literature. This is the most commonly reasons why we do a research, the scholarly literature. So what is that? What would that mean? If you are a student right now, I'm pretty sure this is the main problem for your studies. So when we say scholarly literature, what does it mean? What does it imply? And is that really the problem of your study? So let's go into this. Say scholarly literature, it means there is a gap in research. You wanted to add or to fill the gap in literature. You want to contribute to the gap of research, or you want to provide a voice for the people that is not heard in the literature. And this is really common for qualitative studies, for ethnographic studies, sociological studies. Another reason is to heighten the awareness. If you are my student right now, this can be your problem statement. You want to increase the awareness, you want to lead better understanding, so people are not yet aware of such things, so you want to increase their awareness or to help them understand better, and to lead improvement in practice. So a lot of my students right now are studying frontier technologies, and I believe that this is the main problem that they wanted to address. They want to increase people's awareness about frontier technologies, about the specific frontier technology they are studying. So if you are a student right now, most probably this is your problem statement. You want to address a certain part in literature. Okay, so let's now go to the purpose statement. In writing down the purpose statement, Creswell, the source that I'm using, identified three steps. First is to identify the approach that you are going to use. An example, if you are going to use a case study, a grounded theory, or a narrative study. Second one is that you need to indicate your action or your focus of approach to the inquiry. Are you going to describe a certain case? Are you going to evaluate? Are you going to explore? Are you going to explain? So you have to be specific with that in your purpose statement, that you are only going to describe and you are not going to explain or explore. And last but not the least, be able to identify the central phenomenon, or what we call the main variable of your study. So what are the main focus of your study? You also mentioned not only the variable but also the setting and the participants involved. Creswell also have shared a script in writing down the purpose statement. I'm gonna flash it here. This one is the script that Creswell has shared on how to write the purpose statement. It says there, purpose of this blank study, so it can either narrative, phenomenological, grounded, or case study, is to blank, either you understand, describe, develop, or discover the blank. So you mentioned there the central phenomenon of the study. For the blank, you mean the participant of the study at the given setting. So I'm going to give you an example for my students. They are studying frontier technology, so I gave them a specific technology. So let's say the fifth generation technology. I'm going to use it in an example. So let's say the purpose of this case study is to describe the utilization of the fifth generation technology for education here in the Philippines. So instead of the participants, I mentioned education because that will be the main recipients of the study. One example of a problem and / purpose statement in the background of the study is this one. It's also from the book of Creswell. It says there, although scholars have shown that sport is fundamental in constituting and reproducing gender inequalities, so that is the literature, little attention has been paid to sport and gender relations in later life. So this is the problem statement, little attention has been paid to sport and gender relations in later life. In this article, we demonstrate how men exploit women's labor in the sport of lawn bowls, which is played predominantly by older people. So this highlighted in green is the word demonstrate how. So it means this study is a case study. They will only demonstrate the gender inequalities in a certain area among older people and the sport lawn bowls. So this is very specific. This is very short and very, very concise. So that is how you write the problem and the purpose statement. So that's it for the essential components of the background of the study. Now let's go to the do's and don'ts. What you should do and what you should not do when writing the background of the study. First is, do not define terms. I always see this in majority of the studies that I have read from students. They usually define the terms. According to blah blah blah, this is defined as, that is not proper because definition of terms has a section in the paper. So you don't have to define the terms in the introduction. In order for you to make sure that your readers can easily understand what your variables are or what your phenomenon are about, you should be able to make it relevant. You should be able to present your background of the study in general terms that people will easily understand, even if they are not from the specific field that you are in. Do not jump thoughts. I say do not jump thoughts. What I really mean is that make your paper coherent. So you don't jump from this thought to this thought while you are discussing certain technology and then you jump to the harmful effect. So there's always a proper way to write your paper that makes it coherent, meaning the words, the phrases relates to each other. Next is do quote properly. When we say do quote properly, use citations properly. So write the year of the publication and the name of the author. We use APA, American Psychological Association, as a reference guide. Do not copy unrelated information. So I've always seen this. A lot of students would really just copy and paste the entire abstract of the finding that they got there. You have to summarize the thought of one author and then put it in your terms, and do not copy the entire information that is totally irrelevant to your study. The reason why I have asked you to write background of the study, at least 2 to 3 pages short only. It's because for you to really, really make sure that you will only write important information. So with that, do write concisely. When I say concise, it's short, but it's complete with ideas and the thoughts that I have mentioned, the things that are essentials for the background of the study. That when readers get to open your journals and they see your introduction and they would read your background of the study, they would continue reading the entire paper because they are persuaded with how you write your background of the study. Next is to make it readable. So when I say readable, you follow the standard format. Do not make it an eyesore. So justified, proper spacing, double spaced margins on all sides. Make sure that the text is readable, font size at least 12, and not too small, not too big, and not too really hurt the eyes. So do make it readable. Last but not the least, the most important one, do use words consistently. When I say do use words consistently, it means that when you say describe as the purpose of your study, when you say you just want to describe a certain phenomenon or a certain case, you use it consistently all throughout your paper. You're just going to describe. You're not going to explore. You're not going to explain. You will only describe because you are having a descriptive study. If you want to say you want to increase understanding of a certain phenomenon, you will be consistent with the use of the word understanding. I have this picture. I took it as well from the book of Creswell, and I'm sharing it here with you. You can use this as a guide on how to write your background of the study and the entire study as well, just for you to be consistent with the use of words. Another tip is do not use vague words. If you cannot understand it yourself, then do not use it. Do not use big words just to make it sound more intellectual or appealing to your reader. So again, be consistent with your words. Do not play with your words. So that's it. Those are my do's and don'ts in writing the background of the study. I hope you learned from this video, and if you do, I hope you give this a thumbs up and click the subscribe button and the notification bell down below if you haven't subscribed yet. Follow me on Instagram at @the_learning_mama for more of my life learnings and random musings. Thank you guys for watching, and happy learning. Bye.